am sitting here listening, watching, absorbing, thinking about Ali, even though I never met him. And with this kind of inspiration, I will go and take Trump out tonight.
Omar Navarro, a candidate for Congress in the 43rd District of CA, has called for the arrest of Maxine Waters. I'm calling for the arrest of Maxine Waters. Let's get ready for it. When you are sitting, Congresswoman threatens the president. She needs to get ready for the arrest.
Congresswoman Maxine Waters ramping up her rhetoric against President Trump. The California Democrats started calling for the president's impeachment shortly after the January inauguration. Watch.
Republicans should step up to the plate and confront the fact that this president appears to be unstable. When is the black community going to say, yeah, impeach him? It's time to go after him. I don't hear you.
I've said over and over again, I think he's the most deplorable person I've ever met in my life.
By this time, some say that Waters may have taken it too far. Listen to what she said at a recent New York gala. So there's that. Ben Shapiro, editor-in-chief at DailyWire.com, and Richard Fowler, nationally syndicated radio talk show host and a Fox News contributor. Richard, you know, I'm just watching this, and it isn't really that surprising. I mean, you know, when you look at all of the things that Maxine Waters has said since the inauguration. But I can't help but wonder if, you know, a previous president, President Obama or, you know, President Clinton, if someone had stood up and said that about them, don't you think the outrage on the other side would have been uncontainable?
And I think the outrage was uncontainable. When Ted Nugent threatened to shoot the president, there was outrage on the left, okay. And it was uncontainable. And here's the thing.
He's not a congresswoman, though.
No, I mean, I get that, and I don't think that she was threatening to kill the president in this particular soundbite. I think that some from the right have sort of made this idea that she's trying to threaten to kill him, and I don't think that's what she's saying here. I think she's saying, I'll go take him out, just like somebody like the president would say, I'm going to go take out Hillary Clinton and beat her in the next election, right? It's a very tongue-in-cheek saying. I mean, she's been in Congress since 1991. Nobody believes that she's going to go to the White House and try to physically harm the president in any way.
All right, it's a laughable joke. So you're saying that the rhetoric has devolved so dramatically on all sides that this is just sort of the way we talk now. Ben, what do you think?
I think there's some truth to that. I think there's a pretty outstanding example of just how far the rhetoric has devolved. I mean, Maxine Waters has been saying pretty inflammatory things her entire career. There's a woman who once said that the L.A. riots were really an L.A. uprising. She's used charged language for 20-odd years. She's one of the most corrupt members of Congress. I don't think anyone's particularly surprised by this, but the shouting and cheering for the idea that I'm going to take him out tonight, it's the word tonight that really adds that extra flavor there. It's not just I'm going to take him out in 2018 or 2020. It's we're going to take him out tonight that I think everyone's upset about, and sort of rightfully so.
All right. Let me ask you, go ahead, real quick, Richard.
One thing I want to say, I mean, is the president's rhetoric is almost just as bad. He said he could shoot somebody on Fifth Avenue and still be elected president of the United States, right? So his rhetoric is just as bad. So, I mean, I think to sit here and to criticize Congresswoman Waters, we should also be criticizing the president for using the same type of rhetoric.
Well, we said, is that where we are? And has the conversation devolved to such an extent that we just sort of take this as no big deal? Speaking of rhetoric, let's take a look at this cartoon that was put out in the Daily Californian, which sounds like a sunny newspaper, but that's what they published. It's Alan Dershowitz with his head sort of pushed through, you know, some sort of wall, and the images that are back there depict stomping on the Palestinian flag and an Israeli soldier shooting an unarmed person. And let's also put up what Alan Dershowitz showed us in terms of what was put up at the university on the bulletin board, where there was a swastika drawn over his face. Ben?
I mean, it's pretty shockingly anti-Semitic stuff. This particular cartoon is straight from the pages of Der Stürmer, appearing in the Berkeley newspaper, the suggestion that Alan Dershowitz is a tool of the Israelis, and not only a tool of the Israelis are engaged in Nazi-esque occupation in which they're killing innocent children for no reason at all. And this is, it's pretty obvious, you know, anti-Zionism equaling anti-Semitism in this particular case.
Let's put up a quote from an interview that you guys did at thedailywire.com with Alan Dershowitz, and, you know, he points out, he says, you know, irony is too kind a word. It's hypocrisy. And remember, this is a reaction to a speech in which I said that I support a Palestinian state. And he goes on to say, I support the end of the occupation. I'm against Israeli policies on settlements. You know, and Richard, it just raises the question of whether or not there's some similarities between, you know, sort of the hard the hard progressive left and this neo-Nazi hard right.
Listen, I've said all along, I think that there's racism on both sides of the aisle. I don't care how you split the cookie. I think there's racism in the Democratic Party. I think there's racism in the Republican Party. I think there's homophobia in the Democratic Party. I think there's homophobia in the Republican Party. I don't think homophobia, racism, xenophobia, sexism, I don't think they know party affiliation. I think there's hate in people's hearts, and there's nothing you can do about it. And I don't think it hides under one particular political cloak or another, period.
Ben?
I mean, I think that there's some truth to that. The question is, how close is that hate to the heart of a particular movement? And when you're talking about the anti-Zionism, anti-Semitism of some parts of the left, that seems a lot closer to the heart of the Democratic Party than to the heart of the Republican Party.
I'm sorry.
We gotta go. I'm getting counted down, you guys. But that was a really cheery segment, so thanks a lot. Both sides are horrible. An emotional moment when we come back.
It was one of the Democrats' favorite slogans, when they go low, we go high. Remember that? Well, here's Democratic Congresswoman Maxine Waters. Listen to this.
Thinking about Ali, even though I never met him, and with this kind of inspiration, I will go and take Trump out tonight.
Wow. So at what point, I should ask, does the Secret Service consider this a credible threat? Joining us now to debate this is host of The Blaze, Lawrence Jones, and Democratic strategist and contributor for The Hill, Michael Starr Hopkins. Lawrence, I'll start with you. What'd you think of that?
Look, I'm a free speech person. I'm a libertarian. But when you incite violence, that should be investigated. This is the Democrats going low again. They're more focused on President Trump and rallying up their base than the actual issues of the American people. I'm not so concerned about Maxine Waters. I'm concerned about the people that listened to her, the people that tried to assassinate Republican congressmen at a baseball field. This is the type of behavior that sends these people out to assassinate Republicans.
Michael, what do you think? What you're saying she didn't mean that she wants to assassinate him. How else can you take that?
You know, I think she was talking about impeachment. I don't know what she actually meant. I think that her comment, being that loose with your language, I think is irresponsible. And so I will say that. But what I will also point to is I think that hearing Republicans say that, you know, this is a Democratic issue, when Ted Nugent threatened President Barack Obama and then was invited to the White House under the Trump administration, I didn't hear Republicans saying anything. Lawrence, I didn't hear you say anything when the president was condoning protesters being attacked and he then offered to pay the legal bills. You know, I think both sides are guilty of using hyperbolic language, but I think, Lawrence, it's up to people like me and you to bring down that tenor.
Yeah, but these same congresspeople, especially Maxine Waters, promised after the Steve Scalise shooting that they would tone down the rhetoric. Mm-hmm. And now we have politicians from elected office saying, hey, let's go get the president. And that's essentially what she was saying. You can say that you didn't know what she was saying all you want, Michael, but it's pretty clear what she said. She could have said impeach if she wanted to impeach
him. I've watched you in the last 2 weeks talk about how Democrats want a new Katrina or how Hillary Clinton is a felon. And, you know, it's always the Democrats want to say things, and there's no personal responsibility here.
Well,
and
that's pretty much the Democrats' typical behavior. They play identity politics. They ratchet up the rhetoric. They're not about actions. They could be focusing on how they want to improve the lives of Americans with their policies, but they're not focused on that. They're more concerned about Donald Trump. And if they continue to focus on Donald Trump, the president, instead of the issues that affect the American people, they're going to get landslided again like they've been doing for the last three elections.
Lawrence, with all due respect, I've watched you talk about Hillary Clinton every day for the last month. Hillary Clinton's not the president of the United States. So I'm willing to focus on Donald Trump.
We're talking about Maxine Waters and how she talked about essentially assassinating the president. That's what we're talking about. I didn't mention Hillary Clinton not one time, sir.
She didn't. She didn't say that she wanted to assassinate the president.
Okay, Michael, you know what struck me about the soundbite was when she said that, the crowd started cheering. How did we get this far? Yeah. As a country, as a nation, cheering for possible. I don't know what she meant. We haven't talked to her. She won't come on our show. But it sounded like, I mean, Lawrence is saying it sounded like she said she wanted to assassinate the president tonight.
I agree with you that the crowd shouldn't have cheered. As a congresswoman, she has to be more responsible with her rhetoric, even if that's not what she meant. the appearance, I thought, was inappropriate. Yeah. And so I think she should come out and clarify those comments. But I think that there's also responsibility on the other side when Donald Trump says things in front of crowds and they cheer, for Republicans to call them out. I'm just saying that I think that
there's consistency. When did Donald Trump ever say anything about assassinating anyone or taking someone out? When did he say that?
Donald Trump applauded when protesters were beaten. He said that the crowd should go further. He said that, you know, the protesters that were in
Charlottesville. No, he didn't. He said, get them out of here. That's what he said. That's all he said is get them out of here.
Maybe we'll hear from her. Maybe she'll clarify today and tell us exactly what she meant, because we don't want to read into what she said. All right, thank you so much, both of you, for being here. Lawrence, you're going to be on Outnumbered today at noon. We'll catch you there.
Thanks, Ainsley.
You're welcome. Take care.